Our next speaker today is has been with our organization just a little bit over a month, maybe I think starting his fifth or sixth week here. Bo Cofield joined us as our first Chief Clinical Operations Officer with oversight over our hospitals, our managed facilities, ambulatory and provider-based clinics, off-campus and on-campus, outreach clinics, ancillary services, and associated support infrastructure. Working with Mark Birdwhistle and Murray Clark, Bo reports directly to Dr. Karf and serves as a member of the executive leadership team. He comes to us from the University of Kentucky Medical Center. This is his family. A little before, I had really anticipated seeing them there, but that's a go-with-the-flow thing, right? He has roots in Kentucky. His father's actually a graduate of the UK College of Medicine, and I guess I'm allowed to say the year, 1969, and grew up in Fort Thomas. His mom lived in Corbin for a while until, I think, the middle of her teenage years. Bo attended college in Virginia, has a bachelor's of degree in economics and Spanish. Interesting combination. He followed that with a master's degree from Tulane University in health administration and a doctorate also from Tulane in public health and health systems management. In addition to Virginia, he also has operations and administrative experience at the University of Alabama, Birmingham. Interestingly enough, when he was being interviewed, someone on the team asked him where the Bo came from. And I thought that was sort of his response was pretty interesting. He said, well, there are several Roberts in the family. And by the time he came along, Bo was the only one left to ease the confusion. He believes he's been in a leadership position his entire life, beginning with being a big brother to two sisters, I can only imagine. Professionally, he's been in leadership about 20 years. If he's not gone into healthcare administration, he considered medicine, but not too seriously, he says. What makes him smile was the picture that we just saw, that is Bo with his wife Jennifer and their two kids, Alex and Watson. Where did they go? There they are. They left. Missing from this picture is dog Landon. So even better than the three of when they're all three together with Bo, they have quite the time, so I'm told. The best advice he ever got about being a leader was everything is related. All too true. A little known fact is that Bo and I actually served on the same UHC council, the SOO Council, primarily CEOs from across the nation, from academic medical centers, and I will only remind him that what happens at SOO meetings stay at SOO. Please join with me in welcoming Bo Cofield.
If you could put that picture back up of my family real quick. I learned a new term when this picture was taken, an ussy, not a selfie, coined by the young girl here who would also want me to remind you that the braces are gone. A significant accomplishment in her childhood development. But very glad to be here, not just today, but very glad to be here at the University of Kentucky as we embark upon not just development, because it's in large part developed, but further fleshing out and implementation of the strategy that that Dr. Karf just reviewed. What it takes to deliver on strategy, and you all know this, having done so over the course of the last 10 or 11 years, is leadership. And that's what this week is all about. How do we grow within in order to deliver on the promises that we're making to the citizens of the Commonwealth of Kentucky? And we are a complex organization. We're the most complex of organizations, not just because of the complexity of the patients that we care for, but because of the tripartite mission that we have in academic medicine of blending our clinical care with research and, most importantly, with education. After all, it is the University of Kentucky. And we're here to teach. We're also here to learn and get better ourselves. So let's spend a little bit of time today learning about leadership and what it takes in a complex organization to be a good leader. And we have a lot of special challenges, not just because of that tripartite mission, but because of our size. 11,542 FTEs, I think, was the number that I saw in Dr. Karp's presentation. That is huge. That is absolutely massive. That's the equivalent of a very significant Toyota plant somewhere. But doing things not with inanimate objects, doing things with our patients and with one another in a real-time basis adds to those challenges that we have. We always need to ground ourselves and ask ourselves, and this is the interactive part, what's really important to us? I'm going to call on somebody if you don't answer.
Our patients.
Our patients, that's right. And one another. Mike mentioned earlier about it's not just about our patient satisfaction. I think you all have seen, I'm sure, the data that says for every 1 percentage point change in employee engagement, you see a 2 percentage point change in the same direction in patient experience. So it's a lot as much about one another, if not more so, about one another than it is about our patients. We take care of each other real well. We're certain that our patients will be cared for very well also. That's why they're at the top of this depiction here of the way that I really look at an organizational chart. Our patients at the top, the senior leadership in the bottom. It's our job as senior leaders in the organization or as any leaders in the organization to support those and provide the resources necessary to those who are providing care to our patients each and every day. I like to say that my job in life is to solve problems. When that phone rings, I put it down over there because otherwise it would mess with the microphone, I'm sure. When that phone rings, it's not somebody usually calling to congratulate me. Somebody calling to deliver a problem at my feet. And our job in life as leaders is to solve problems for our directors, our administrators and chairs, supervisors, managers, and medical directors, most importantly, empowering the working teams that are comprised of our staff, our faculty, and our learners across the organization to support our patients. When I was asked to give this presentation, even before I landed on the ground, Mr. Zembrot sent me an email, I think, about 2 days after the announcement that I was joining the University of Kentucky. They said, we'd love for you to share your vision with the University of Kentucky leadership team. And I said, are you out of your mind? I will have been here like 5 or 6 weeks at that point in time. No way will I have developed a vision. And so talking with Colleen and with Jim and others, decided to focus a little bit on some important tenets of leadership. And went back to, you'll learn this about me, I can't stand management books for the most part. I like the ones that are, however, that are fables. So the five dysfunctions of a team, death by meeting, which is a really good one. We are the masters in complex organizations of meetings. That's how we get things done, through consensus, which requires face-to-face time. But there is one management book that actually is, I think, 27 or 28 years out now. The first edition came in 1987. It was by Kuz and Posner, The Leadership Challenge, How to Get Extraordinary Things Done in Organizations. And you'll notice that they've advanced so far now that you can even get an app with the book. Didn't have that in this cool depiction in 1987. This book is interesting to me because what Kuz and Posner did is actually evolved this body of work. They started with a very significant engagement of leaders across the country in organizations at that time, not just in healthcare, some in healthcare, a lot in industry. And the years have rolled by, they've updated this. They're on their fifth edition with more and more data points to really hammer home that the model they developed of 5 practices and 10 commitments that leaders can and should make are bearing themselves out in just about any industry in the world. And the first one here, and we'll talk about this probably in more detail than anything else, is modeling the way. And leaders' job is to deliver we're very visible, we're very well observed by those with whom we work. And if you have the opportunity to clarify your values by finding your voice and affirming shared ideas with those you work most closely with, it's very important. And that will enable you to set an example by aligning examples with shared values. Again, we'll talk about that in a moment. The second practice that they suggest is a good way to lead in an organization is to inspire shared vision. That's not just like the vision Dr. Karpf just went through here up here. That is your local vision as well. What is your teachable point of view about how it is that your work gets done in your area of responsibility each and every day? need to engage your staff by imagining exciting and enabling possibilities, and enlist your staff or your team members in a common vision by appealing towards shared aspirations. That may differ in respiratory therapy than in physical therapy, than in nursing, than in administration or finance. And so finding your vision in your area of responsibility is something that you should focus on as we work to deliver this on this strategic plan. Challenge the process. This one might be my favorite one, and we're really good at this in academic medicine, in large part because we like to study things. We like to push back. Our job as scientists, we're all naturally attracted probably to academic medicine because we've got a little bit of scientist in each and every one of us. Think about it, is to prove the null. Let's challenge the process. Let's challenge and search for opportunities by seizing the initiatives and by looking outward for innovative ways to improve. Ann mentioned the SOO Council. That's one way where I seek out, and I know that this organization is heavily involved in UHC, HFMA, and other organizations. It's a great way to learn about how others are taking experiments, or making experiments, and taking risks prior to us. Let's apply those things back here and generate small wins, learn from those experiences, and build upon those. The last two practices and the last four of the 10 commitments are enabling others to act. As I mentioned earlier, my job in life and our job is in our lives as leaders is really to enable others to do their work the best way that they can. Give them the resources that they need to care for patients or to support those who do so quite directly, and fostering collaboration and by building trust and facilitating relationships between the areas that we're all responsible for. I find that you can strengthen others by increasing your own self-determination and developing competence. So if I'm competent at my work, perhaps as a leader, it fosters others to be competent in their work as well. And then lastly, and probably the most important thing, and this really is actually one of the benefits of being in healthcare, and if you read Kuz and Posner, they actually indicate that healthcare does this better than anybody else, which is encouraging the heart. And that's really about being sure that we're recognizing those who are doing the work each and every day, thanking them, recognizing their contributions for individual and team excellence, and celebrating the values and victories by creating a spirit of community. That's actually a good segue to sort of a charge that I'd like to give everybody about modeling the way. But I had very early on in my time here the opportunity to help everybody deliver candy to our frontline team members who are doing the work each and every day. I tell you, the folks with the greatest surprise on their faces. Ann and I went to the MS, the labs. They were really surprised when we were recognizing their work, but it did really start to spark a spirit of community. So one thing that isn't mentioned necessarily in that model that I just reviewed, the five practices and the 10 commitments, is credibility. And Kuz and Posner focus on this greatly, but credibility truly is the foundation of leadership. If we're not credible as leaders, if I'm not believable as a leader, if I'm not honest, forward-looking, inspiring, and there's that word again, competent at what it is that I do, why would I expect anybody to follow me? Why should you expect anybody to follow you as well? So what does credibility look like? Again, the interactive portion of the engagement here. Visible, absolutely. What else? Not contradicting ourselves, not contradicting the mission, the vision, the values of the organization. And when do we appear to contradict? When we don't do what we said we'd do. We make a commitment to do something as leaders, we better deliver on it. Or if you're not going to deliver on it, be honest about it. Be clear that you need help getting something done. Mike mentioned earlier that this is a team sport, sometimes full contact with no pads. You'll hear me say that frequently. But if we can't deliver on something we said we're going to do, we need to ask for help and get that done. Because we don't make decisions or make commitments because they're just fun things to do. We do that because we want to care for patients. We want to care for patients very well across the Commonwealth. So I'm going to issue, I like to leave each and every one of these sessions with a bit of a challenge. And I'm going to issue a challenge, tell a little story, but issue a challenge surrounding model the way. And it involves my kitchen table. Some of you have heard this story, but I'm sort of bringing together my move in my first couple of days or first few weeks here as well. So invited to participate in the employee appreciation, and it reminded me, or some of my time there reminded me of something that happened to us during our move. So I was out and about pushing a cart, getting hit in the face with balloons. Those of you who push that cart are familiar with that feeling, and delivering candy across the organization and talking with folks about the great work that they do, a great opportunity for me to learn. But as I was doing that, and you'll notice as I walk through the halls, I do nothing but bend over and pick up pieces of garbage. Pieces of trash across the organization. We have as many people walking through this organization as live in most towns in Kentucky, if you think about it. And that generates a good bit of waste. But as I was doing that, somebody indicated that I was walking with, that's fantastic, I just don't see it anymore. It's become a part of the wallpaper. This is the kitchen table that got left behind when we moved. So my wife, Jennifer, who you saw a picture of, is an absolute a stickler for details. And in our contract, it's when we sold our house, and we're going to leave that house clean. And so she got up at 6 a.m. This actually was the morning after the movers loaded the truck and headed out over here to Lexington. She got up at about 5:30 because she needed to get on the road at about 10 or 11 in order to get to the kids' school for back to school night before school started. And I get a text at about, she leaves at about 5:30, something like that. I get a text at about 5:45 after she gets coffee and gets to the house, that sort of stuff. All caps, they left the kitchen table behind. Not but 5 seconds after that text, the phone begins to ring. Again, as I mentioned, it's not usually somebody calling to congratulate me. It's really not somebody calling to congratulate me at 5:30 in the morning. It's my wife calling, how in the heck are we going to get this kitchen table on top of our car or whatever the case may be? And I just asked the question, how in the world do you leave behind a kitchen table? Well, here's why. We had a Post and Beam house in Charlottesville. There's, by the way, this is where I kept my beer keg, and there's the opener right there. After that kegerator got usurped for orange juice for the kids, but this is why it got left behind. It became a part of the wallpaper. These guys left at about 11 o'clock at night. It was dark. It was inside of my garage. Got left behind. Well, as I started to think about the comment that was made to me, I just don't see it anymore, this really rang home. Who's seen that before? It's my favorite one. I stood there for about a minute or so, and you can see just in that five-second period right there, there's three people who walked by all this stuff. Staff only beyond this point means that this is behind the scenes. Oh, we almost made it into the garbage on that one. Who sees this? These are the hardest ones to find. The clear ones, the little candy wrappers. This isn't a candy wrapper. It's something that came with one of our supplies. And there it is, the candy wrapper of the candy we delivered. In a staff elevator 3 days later. We met the enemy, it is us. So I'm going to issue a challenge. What I want you all to do, what I want you to do is model the way. Pick up garbage at least 3 times a day. What I do, I have 3 vitamins here in my pocket, and I move one to my left pocket for each piece of trash I pick up over the course of a day. Usually I get that done by about 8 a.m., 8:15, given the opportunities that we have here. But this is a way that we can model the way to our team members and our faculty and our patients, most importantly, that we care about the environment in which we work. There's no better way for us to demonstrate that we care about this building, the people we care for, than being sure that it's clean. Would we leave that candy wrapper on the floor in our home? Probably not. Now, my kids would, for sure, but we I don't think that we would. And so please, take an opportunity, take the opportunity to be very deliberate about caring for the environment. Demonstrate that you do so by modeling the way each and every day. Let's get back to leadership. One of the big components of leadership isn't about what great decisions we make. It's how we influence the right decisions, how we influence the right way of doing things. And think about influence, not your role in the organization as a leader. Think about how you can influence your team members to make good decisions, to make the right decisions for our patients each and every day. Put completing fellow leaders ahead of competing with them. It's a team sport. We shouldn't compete with our team members. We should complete our team members. You can read the rest of these, but I think it's really important to know that we have a wealth of domain experts. Please respect their knowledge and the contributions that they can make. This is one of the reasons I love and have only ever worked in academic medical center, because we have rooms full of people like this who are leaders in an organization. If we were at, say I was down at Hazard a couple weeks ago, if we had this session there, probably wouldn't fill up the first two rows with the leaders. We've got a lot of wealth and knowledge that we can draw upon here in this organization. So let's try not to do it alone. Bring those experts into your circle. And widen your definition of a colleague. Bring people who can into conversations who can help you get the right things done for our patients. And that includes clinical partners and business partners. So thank you for choosing to lead at UK Healthcare. All of us influence more than we appreciate. We are, I think somebody mentioned earlier, visible. Visibility is one of those key traits of good leaders across society, and particularly in healthcare. So please be visible, but know that you're being watched. You will make a difference if you do the right things and do the right activities in aspiration that tomorrow will be even better than today. And it always takes great energy, passion, and constant thoughtfulness to do our work well. Back to constant thoughtfulness. Be constantly thoughtful that there's a piece of garbage on the floor somewhere that you can pick up and make this a better place to work and a better place to care for patients each day.